Good evening, everyone. My name is Kimberly McQuarrie, and I'm the Director of Community Programming and the Co-Director of the Innovation Labs here at the Dalí Museum. Out of all of the programs that we present, as a former academic, lectures are really close to my heart because I feel that the sharing of knowledge from people who are speaking from their experiences and their areas of expertise have the ability to enrich and, if I might dare say, change our lives. And I think that specifically, we're being joined today by Brian Longstreth to talk about the founding of St. Pete Pride. And this kind of history lesson, I would hope all of us would agree, is needed now more than ever, because when our rights are under attack by outside forces, it's more important than ever for us to understand what happened in the past and what has brought us to this present moment, so that we can be fortified and strengthened by that. And so I'm really just honored that Brian will join us. So I just want to say a few words. It's actually impossible to say a few words about Brian, because he's a true Renaissance man and has apparently is allergic to leisure time. He is that very rare bird here in Florida, which is a native Floridian. And he was born in Bradenton before moving to the Tampa Bay area and settling in his home now of St. Pete. His early career in restaurant and retail led to him becoming a realtor and getting very involved in the neighborhoods of St. Petersburg. And this was really a launching pad for his interest in impact and community impact. He was instrumental in the resurgence of the Grand Central District, historic Kenwood, and Central Oak Park neighborhoods. And this led to then him becoming more involved widely in city, state, and county politics, specifically supporting LGBTQ+ friendly politicians. And he was able to, through this platform, co-chair St. Pete Pride in 2003, and then served on the board for many years, bringing the International InterPride Conference to St. Pete in 2009. On the real estate side, he's also converted an apartment building to the Gay St. Pete House, B&B, changing the name to Casa del Merman in 2021, and then expanding to a second location in Montañita, Ecuador. Now, this is where I say, he's obviously allergic to leisure, because that's not enough. In 2014, he and his brother James took the lead on getting a historic bungalow donated to Metro Inclusive Health to become the LGBTQ Welcome Center in the Grand Central District. And then, that's not enough, a founding member of Come Out St. Pete as a means to celebrate National Coming Out Day locally, and served on the board. He led a group of investors to open a bar and grill on Central Avenue. And although he had sold that interest, not before meeting his future husband, Sam Thatsawat, whom he married in October 2021. Keeping them busy are two rescue dogs, Whiskey and Cola. I highly approve of those names. And most recently, Brian and his business partner have spent a lot of time in Montañita, Ecuador, opening Casa del Merman at Gay Montañita House, Merman Beach Club, Bar and Restaurant, and the Sunset Chill Lounge. Plans are underway, because you don't think he's going to stop now, do you? Plans are underway for condominiums and an LGBTQ+ retirement community in Montañita soon, as well as expanding Montañita Pride in July of 2022. So with that very impressive history behind him, I welcome Brian to the stage to share with us a little bit about St. Pete Pride.
Good afternoon. Evening. Afternoon. Happy hour. Before I get into St. Pete Pride, I just kind of wanted to remind people what the first original Pride celebration was. It was a riot. People were getting arrested and harassed in New York City because they were in bars dancing together, speaking with one another, drinking together. And the community had reached a point where enough was enough. And that was led by transgender people and women of color fighting for their right to assembly free from harassment. I'm not going to get too political, but by the way, I am gay. So it's always Pride started as a political event and a fight for the rights. Many prides nationwide and around the world sometimes stray from that as they get bigger. They become more about parties and entertainment and raising money, and big money sometimes gets involved and it changes things. And part of what happened in St. Petersburg, we kind of had a growth that started really around 1999 with the Suncoast Resort, a big hotel on 34th Street South, bringing a lot of gay people to St. Petersburg for extended stays. We had Georgie's Alibi, which was a popular restaurant, open on 31st Street and 3rd Avenue North. The Grand Central District had become a plan for revitalization, which turned a lot of empty storefronts into operating businesses. Many of them were gay-owned. We got their florist, we got the picture framer, we got the leather shop. One longtime bar converted over to a new bar called Grand Central Station. And so the Grand Central District was kind of becoming known as the new Castro in the area, after Castro in San Francisco. With support of the surrounding neighborhoods, historic Kenwood, Palmetto Park, Central Oak Park, they had been working to clean up the area, and those neighborhoods were also becoming more and more gay. In 2002, Tampa Bay Pride, which all the events were in Tampa, not Tampa Bay, kind of imploded. And for years, there'd been a couple of rocky years with Tampa Bay Pride. And their doom was renting Raymond James Stadium, the old one, not the new one, hiring Pat Benatar as a performer for a reported $60,000. Not sure of that real number. There was no parade. You had to actually buy a ticket to the concert to actually see any vendors and get any other information about the community. That did not go well. There was a lot of infighting and, you know, lawsuit threats and, you know, where'd the money go? And so that started a conversation in late 2002. Can we do something in St. Pete that's more St. Pete focused? And so the talks were pretty informal for several months. Into 2003, we decided to hold a town hall meeting in February. And this is pre-Facebook and pre-social media, so it was all flyers and posters. And about 100 people showed up for a meeting at DT's Bar on Central Avenue. And there was some pretty good discussion about what we wanted and didn't want to do. There were some people from Tampa that said, oh, we can do that, we can do that. And we basically said, no, this is going to be a St. Pete thing. And the city had recently amended their human rights ordinance to include sexual orientation. So we were kind of recognizing that as well. And at that meeting, it was pretty much committees started forming right away. And that was kind of one of the funny things to me, looking back, the number of people that just stepped up that didn't know anything about them. We had Ed Cassidy, was a marketing manager for the St. Petersburg Times, pretty good position. And he said, I'll take over sponsorship. I'll handle getting sponsorships. I'm like, there's a good guy to have on sponsorships, somebody of that caliber. Robert Danielson was in the marketing department at the city and somewhat in the closet at work. He was fearful for his job, but he wanted to work on this project, and he did a great job. Jay Aller, a 20-year-old website and graphic person, was my neighbor, and he wanted to help. And I thought we were going to have the actual city logo. If you've seen the official city logo, it's basically a four-color logo with a pelican in front. And so we wanted to kind of take a little bit of a stab at the city. And so that's why you see the logo at the top, and on this shirt is a pelican with the rainbow logo on it. The mayor at the time, Rick Baker, fairly conservative, not a anti-gay person, but just not supportive. I think he was okay with the event as long as it stayed in Grand Central. He didn't want it downtown. And all of the departments that we had to work with to put this together, the sanitation, police, everybody, seemed like they were hopping over themselves to help us. And I think it was just kind of their own little way to put a little jab at him. We had Carol Scanameo, a former New York City police officer, offer to handle security. And Ellen Levitt, co-chair, had experience in Long Beach Pride, Long Island Pride. And she said, yeah, I've run organizations before. I'd be happy to help. She stepped up. She was a calming voice for many of us. Jerry Broman, financial background, became our treasurer. So we really just all came together, and with the short time frame we were on, that meeting was February 20th, I believe, and we had planned, again, to try to keep history important to our goal, to do it on the traditional last weekend of June. And we always heard about, you know, how hot it was in June, blah, 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 blah. And our response was always, it was hot in New York City in June of 1969. So we've always stuck to that. We've always tried to have some education components. We had involved the Holocaust Museum. We showed the movie Paragraph 175, about the Holocaust and the persecution of gays and gypsies in Nazi Germany, which is eerily, you know, you hear more and more about Nazism lately. We did lots of things with the arts community, the Fine Arts Museum, the Arts Center. We did a few things. We had a Stonewall reception, again, kind of reminding people why we were doing what we were doing. We also wanted to make sure we had other age brackets involved. We had a family values picnic on Spa Beach with Equality Florida that very first year. Knowing what had happened financially with Tampa Pride and many other prides with entertainment, we decided to let other venues take the risk on concerts and things. The Suncoast Resort became the closing finale party for many years. That first year, they brought in Maxine Nightingale. Who knows the song? Come on, somebody's got to. Gonna get right back to where we started from. I don't do karaoke, so I'm sorry. Double M Band, who still performs locally, opened for that concert. So that was 20 years ago. Yeah, that's right. Future years, they had the Weather Girls, Taylor Dane, many other great acts that allowed St. Pete Pride to put their name on this finale party without any of the risk that occurred with other entertainment and other prides. And we would almost always hear every year, who's going to be the entertainment? Who are you bringing in? Who are you bringing in? And we're like, we're not bringing in Pat Benatar. Okay, so we're going to highlight local acts and let somebody else do the other part. When we were talking about the event itself, we talked about, do we want a march? Do we want a parade? And we kind of kept going back and forth and weren't quite sure what to call it. You know, a march was a little too militant, a parade was a little too happy at the time. And I was sitting at a bar in Key West, and there was a poster that had Promenade for something. I don't know what the event was for. And I may have been having a few cocktails. But I started calling somebody, let's call it a promenade. And so that worked for the first couple of years until it got so big that it had to become a parade. So we had many, you know, expectations. We thought, you know, if we had 2,000 people come up that first day, we'd be really happy. And we ended up with about 10,000. We had the picture you see, and it's, you know, if you've been on Central Avenue, this is 26th Street, 25th, and that's 24th at the end there.
That's the VIP right there.
This is all the vendors. This area had cars, antique cars, so there weren't even vendors here. We were just filling the street. And then this flag was actually brought up from Wilton Manors, the Georgie's Alibi flag, and we unfurled it. And that went for about 10 years with the flag, which was really good. I thought, you know, we were pretty forward-thinking to actually get an aerial flight before drones existed. It cost some money, but we thought it was worth it. So many of the experiences that I had the first year were the personal interactions with people that I didn't know. We were walking up the parade route before it started, excuse me, and there was a family setting up a blanket in the yard and bringing out their two younger kids. And the parents were like, we just wanted to teach our kids about diversity. And I was like, wow, that's really cool. I had a teenager come up to me and say, thanks for doing St. Pete Pride. I finally came out to my parents because Pride discussion came up. I had a mid-20s woman talk about she came out at work because she asked for the day off so she could attend Pride. She hadn't been out yet. And then there's an 80-year-old gentleman who was almost in tears because he had said his wife had passed away last year, the year before, and he had been faithful to her, and now that she was gone, he could become himself and explore this side of him. And you know, those things, those kinds of comments really stuck with me and still do. And it reminds me continually, we do it for the future and for people. We knew we had a good formula with that turnout. We knew by keeping the main events free, that keeping the vendor fees low, allowed all small businesses to participate and nonprofits to participate. And good efforts on sponsorships to cover the cost. That first year, we ended up with some extra money left over. We didn't know what to do with it. We knew we wanted to put some aside for the next year. So we attended an InterPride conference. InterPride is the global organizations where Pride groups get together and have conferences and discuss how to do things and create better events, et cetera. And so we went to the conference, and they have parties too. I know. We asked, what do you do with the money left over? And they're like, you had money left over your first year? Crazy. So that first year, we donated $17,000 back to the community, to other nonprofits, and set aside $10,000 for the following year. In 2007, after our doubling our attendance almost every year, we applied to host InterPride, the actual international conference here in St. Petersburg, and we won that and hosted it in 2009. And that brought people from around the world to St. Petersburg, and it continues to put St. Petersburg on the map as a LGBTQ+ friendly destination. Back in 2005, Rhonda Storms introduced in Hillsborough County the ban support of Pride, based mostly off a library display. And that actually boosted St. Pete Pride, just more fuel for the fire of why it's important to do what we were doing. And we were fortunate in Pinellas County, nobody else, no other politician decided that was a good thing to do. We knew we were successful when we started getting protesters in the third year. So great, they're here, now we have to deal with them, which is always fun. We have, oh, there's the city logo. Do I control that? Maybe I hit the keyboard, I don't know. Oh, I do, how about that? If I'd only known. There's 2007.
But remember that first video, first picture was here with about half of it being cars and not really vendors to almost 11 blocks of vendors. This was, I think, 2007. We estimated about 120, 140,000 people. That was when the festival and the parade were on the same day.
same time. The parade actually came through the festival, which as it grew became problematic, to say the least. I think it's also kind of funny, this balloon arch that's kind of blowing in the wind, protester cut it, so it's kind of flying away. But you can see some of your favorite haunts in the district are still there. Lucky Star down here, in the garage. That first year, you know, again, we had a lot of stuff going on, and we had one person had an idea that we should have a parasail contest to help with the sun and have kind of a fun thing with it and make sure. And we had a few people kind of blow back that, oh, that's not serious, that's too cute, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, if I can wear this, I don't care. It keeps the sun out of my eyes and my hands free. So it was a lot of fun. But the relationships and the fun that we had in St. Pete Pride, I think, continue, and the benefits of St. Pete Pride to our community continue to this day. Rick Kreisman was one of our earliest supporters. He was on city council at the time when Rick Baker was mayor. He was the only city council member that, I mean, I am going to take this off because it's annoying. He was the only city council member that would sign the proclamation, and the only one that would do it for several years. Then he became mayor much later, and he was the first mayor to raise the rainbow flag over City Hall. Jim, what year was that? Yeah, I was going to say 8 years ago. It had to be. And that simple gesture, again, had its controversy at the time. But look what's happening in the Tampa Bay region now. Tampa, Gulfport, Treasure Island, Largo, St. Pete Beach, Clear. And they're all either doing rainbow flags or proclamations. And that started because of St. Pete. The model of St. Pete of keeping it simple, keeping it basic, keeping it based on community has been copied around the globe, because people saw how successful it was. You also look in the Tampa Bay area, I never would have thought we would have had a Pasco Pride. Sure enough, there was, and they've been doing well, and without a lot of battles up in Pasco County. There's Polk County Pride. Sarasota Pride is kind of re-energized. There was my hometown of Punta Gorda, had a Pride celebration. I escaped Punta Gorda as a little kid, not knowing why I was different, but I knew I didn't want to grow up there. For them to have a Pride celebration, I went back, and it was very emotional to do that. But that's how, you know, something like St. Pete Pride helped not just change St. Pete, it's changed the Tampa Bay area. And I take a lot of pride in doing that. I'm forever thankful the group of people that did that first year. It was just amazing. The ability to just, you know, we were fortunate. We didn't have time to argue about a lot of stuff. We just had to get it done. And we had, you know, the talented community step up and make it happen. And I just think with the current attacks that trans community women are under and what's on the bill ahead of us, it's more important than ever to be out, proud, and be yourself. And be gay, 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 gay as fuck. That's all I have. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer.
What was the first year you had a segue?
Oh, that's good. I always remember that because Scott Turner was the crazy one on a segue. That was probably 2006 or 7, I think. Segways for because it had gotten so big, trying to get the volunteers to handle all of that going back and forth. I weighed a lot less then, and I certainly weighed a lot less after every Pride event because we walked up and down the street so many times. Funny story, speaking of Scott Turner, we had talked about doing a fundraiser, doing a cross-dressing event. And So we were all talking about where do we get wigs, where do we get dresses, blah, 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 blah. Scott Turner, for those that don't know him, he's a pretty masculine guy. You know, he's muscular, you know. He goes, I have a drag box. I'm like, what? He goes, I have a drag box. We go over to his house, and in his attic, it's not just a little box. It is a huge box of wigs, shoes, everything that we needed for our event, for our fundraiser. One of our early events was at the old Dali. We had a taste, one of the first Taste of Prides was there in the little meeting room that was a storage room that was smaller than this room. But it was a successful fundraiser. And again, we tried to do a lot of those little different fundraisers to involve the community in different things. We wanted to raise money to make sure that we could have a free event, could have a parade that everybody could attend. We could have a street festival that everybody could attend. And that was cornerstone to what we wanted to do.
Back in 1994, I was the president of my neighborhood association, SNOA. There was a man, a retired dentist, doctor. His partner was named Philip. They lived on Snow Island. He did an amazing amount of work for the Property Owners Association. A terrific person. He was one of the main people that opened up that, I call it the Boys Club on 34th Street, that you already called it.
Yes, Suncoast Resort. Lester?
His partner was Philip, but I can't remember.
Yeah, I know who you're talking about. I can't remember his name either. Yeah. And also, to be clear, we were not the first Pride event in St. Petersburg. There were some earlier marches, demonstrations, et cetera. I think we were the first one that was organized around a group of events to include a parade and festival. And so we don't claim to be the first Pride event in St. Pete. We claim to be the first St. Pete Pride. Yes? Well, first off, I have not been involved for several years, so, but I think the key really is we've always wanted to make sure, maintain that it was a peaceful protest, and even when we had protesters who were interfering in our festival with signs and bullhorns walking down the middle of it, we did everything we could to try to keep people safe, and we pulled back people that were getting in heated discussions. To maintain, try to maintain decorum and taking the high road. I think it is important to continue to be involved and engaged with our politicians. And I think you saw that, I think, in some close elections in the past where, the deciding factor is a very small margin. And that's how we've tried to maintain is remain engaged. It is political. And it's important to be engaged. I think there will be, if they turn back more rights, as seems to be on the radar, I think there will be more demonstrations and more actions. But our goal is to always keep them peaceful. We did Come Out St. Pete last year. George Floyd, because the COVID canceled the parade. Come Out St. Pete worked with St. Pete Pride and did a march with Black Lives Matter. It really wasn't a march. It was, we just unfurled the flag, everybody at a safe distance, and did a demonstration. We did not want to let the day go by without showing our solidarity with the Black community. Yes?
Things I remember about St. Pete Pride was one of the biggest parties gathering to a house was at the Veterans of Foreign War.
Yes.
On Central and on 25th.
Yep.
These old guys in there drinking beer at the bar, they were just happy, patting people on the butt.
It brought out a lot of smiles and good times for people that you didn't really expect it to. You know, that became known as the gay VFW for quite a while.
And cheap drinks, yes.
But those were kind of the unexpected things and the responses that I enjoyed. Can't see anymore. Anybody else? Yes? Sherwood or the Wedgwood?
Wedgwood Inn was one too.
Right.
Sherwood was next to what was the Big Catch by the.
Yeah. By the hotel. I do remember the Sherwood now that.
Hotel, Sherwood,
yep. That was kind of.
Good place.
Yep.
And El Goya.
Yeah. In Tampa. Yes. Well, and there's in the building that is across from Enigma, it's a restaurant now, but it was when it became Savannah's Cafe, 1100 block of Central Avenue, it was a gay bar back in the 70s and 80s called the Club on Central. And I remember when it became Savannah, I think I mentioned Rick Baker and I had known each other for quite a while, and I kind of enjoy kind of ribbing him every once in a while, and he just kind of laughed it off. But he was there for the grand opening of Savannah, and I happened to be in the booth right behind him. So I was speaking to my friend rather loudly that, yeah, this used to be a gay bar. There was a staircase there that the drag queens had come down, and just to give him a little ribbing, you know, again, he was not really anti-gay. He was just very conservative. His comment was usually, "He didn't want to bring his daughter to the Pride celebration." Regardless of the fact that there were, you know, thousands of children having a great time there, but that's his choice.
A good question about there seems to have been some migrations of Pride in the Tampa Bay area from one side of the bay and back. They seem to be catalysts off of, you know, either the large Suncoast Resort closing, had the big move to Gayport. How do you think that impacts the area? Is it a positive?
I think it is a positive, actually. You know, for years, again, it took a long time for Tampa to kind of come back from what happened in 2002, and for people to trust people again over there. When you start throwing around financial impropriety and things like that, it's really hard to regain the trust. And there were some starts before. You know, the Tampa Winter Pride was in February, had a good start, but just kind of petered out. And then you almost always have to do it in your community, where your community is. And that's why I think it worked in Grand Central so well, and still does. The festival works great there. And that's why Ybor City is a kind of a natural place for it. Now, the gay nightlife scene in Ybor right now is kind of on the downside for the gay community, so we'll see. But I think it's healthy for the entire region. Sean? Sure that I said thank you for all the dedication, the years of hard work, the true loving kindness that
shown the community because you have succeeded in your mission. You've created such an amazing thing that's going to live on and create that safe environment for the future generations to be themselves.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
You know, one thing I remember about the 70s and 80s is that the gay clubs were mostly gay men clubs. Mm-hmm. But that's where we, as married couples, I'm not gay, we would, it was the best parties, the best places to go to celebrate. It was so much fun. The show was
they no still are,
sweetie. We traveled to Tampa to go to Algoria and the and the Wedgwood Inn was a wonderful place to eat and just be around people. But it was just they were beautiful places to go to have fun. There's no shit about it, just to have fun. I don't know that that's happening now.
It seems that many of the bars have kind of segregated a little bit more. I mean, Georgie's Alibi, I think, was very successful at bringing everybody together again. Punky's has certainly got a diverse crowd. Cocktail has got a pretty good diverse crowd. And so many of the bars now, because the neighborhoods surrounding it are so gay, but there's a lot of straight people there. And a lot of the straight people move there for that reason. They wanted to be in a neighborhood that was diverse and welcoming and, for the most part, progressive. And so everybody is welcome. And that's the moniker that you know, we have to get back to in making sure that everybody feels welcome, every age, every race, every gender, the whole list of, you know, we are welcome sign and alphabet soup there is. But, you know, as an old white guy, I feel very sensitive and empathetic to people in minority communities. And within the gay community, we have a lot of issues there, especially with the older white guys. It's like, stop it. Yes, you made it. You got successful. Stop looking down on people who haven't got it there yet or haven't reached that same level of acceptance. Give a hand out and reach up.
I have a question, Brian. In those early days, Robert was working sponsorships, and I know you said there were no other than Rick when he was on city council. Were there challenges? Was there a lot of pushback, like in that sponsorship realm? Or, you know, and I'm framing it in the sense of it was all before social media. So it was either old school cold calling, stopping into somebody's business. And when you think of that and you're presenting this subject matter in the Sunshine State, I just wonder if you can speak to any of that dynamic or if any politicians like went out of their way to just be obstinate or different.
There were several instances.
So I'm not asking for names.
Yeah, I'll try not to. But
yeah. Who knows?
If it slips out, it slips out. No. I was also involved with the discussions when we were amending the human rights ordinance in St. Petersburg, and that was a lot of hand-holding with politicians about why it was important. And if you remember, they did not include transgender in the human rights ordinance originally. We had to come back and do it. And so that was a lot of the discussion with politicians about, you know, in dealing with, you know, I'm sitting next to Nadine Smith, who's such an eloquent speaker on the topic. And in dealing with some of these politicians, and they're like, you know, she would try to mention some of the parallels with the civil rights fight. And some people just weren't having that. They were like, no, 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 don't you dare compare the two. So on the business side, we kind of knew who our allies were. And I mean, that was kind of the beauty of that first year of having Ed Cassidy take the lead on it. He knew who would write checks, and it just kind of spawned from there. We had one of our first Pride Night at Tropicana. I think the first year was 2004. That was essentially, I rented the booth, donated it to St. Pete Pride, who sold the tickets to raise money for St. Pete Pride. The Rays were not, this is a different ownership group, they were not really into it. they were like, okay, you can rent the booth. In one of those discussions, one of the marketing people there outed one of their own players. And I was my jaw dropped. I was like, you know, if there happened to be a player that might be willing to show support, that'd be great. And she kind of turned and looked at the other person. Well, what about da 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 da? And I'm like, oh my God. Never heard from him, so you know, apparently he wasn't ready. But then, you know, just a few years later, with the It Gets Better video, I had seen the It Gets Better video that the San Francisco Giants had done. They were the first team to do it. And I sent it to my contact person at the Rays, and I said, we should do this. And this was the current ownership group who enthusiastically said yes. And we kind of went through and picked the players we want. Some of them were just because they were cute. Some of them were because they represented a minority. And then we had the coach, Joe Madden. And all of the players were amazingly supportive of it. It really was such a really neat experience. And it gets better video. You can look it up. It's pretty good. It supports the Trevor Project in fighting teen suicide. That, to me, is still one of the most enjoyable events I was involved in. So.
After Orlando, the Rays.
Right. Yeah.
The next game, they had these shirts for everybody free.
Yeah, didn't they? $5 for every seat and the shirts. And the Rays, the organization, has stepped up in big ways. They were one of the first companies to sign on the Marriage Equality Act and do several other things on a national level that other baseball teams have not done. So I give them a whole lot of credit for that. And they just gave Metro Inclusive Help $20,000.
$20,000 on Friday, that's right.
Yeah, nice. Yeah, so.
And over the years, I'll say, I work at Metro Inclusive Help, and the Rays have always been super supportive in any way that they can be, financially and otherwise. So. Despite those recent headlines that may have you thinking something poorly of the Rays,
yeah,
they're a great organization, and I think very supportive, I can sense.
Uh-oh. I'll stop touching buttons.
Yeah. Right.
Question about, you know, we talk a lot about Rick Christman. How has it been impacted having three LGBTQ city council members, which we have none?
Right.
Being on city council as you went into the future of Pride.
Yeah, that was big at the time. We were, you know, anytime an election comes around, you know, St. Pete Pride gets in, they don't directly get involved, but, you know, the people in the community get involved and they kind of see who's being endorsed and who's not being endorsed, et cetera. And, you know, Steve Cornell was first, thank you. And Darden Rice, wow. See, I told you, I'm getting old. And they came along, and that was, again, you'd have to look at probably Wilton Manors in Fort Lauderdale as the gayer city of the two. But that, again, was one of those things that helped put St. Petersburg on the map as an LGBT destination that continues to pay off to this day, especially if you're in real estate. When we started in Grand Central District, you know, houses in historic Kenwood were going for about 80,000. They're about 800,000 now, I think. I was going to say, oh, Metro Inclusive Health. That was also a big growth period for Metro. They used to be above King of Peace Church up on Fifth Avenue and opened their first real office next to Georgie's Alibi at the same time as the start of St. Pete Pride. I remember they were there the first year. I don't know if they were actually open yet, but I know we used them for bathrooms, and they were selling water, I think. No. But the growth of Metro Inclusive Health is tied closely, I think, with St. Pete Pride and the growth of the community.
And to that, can I ask about how HIV messaging, or, you know, in 2003, by that point, you know, the eight different ages, I can't see it, you know, it's a diverse group in the room, so we all have a different kind of timeline of the HIV epidemic, pandemic, crisis.
Mm-hmm.
The crisis, it was a pretty scary time. Agreed. And I'm was any of that kind of involved in those early days? You
know? We were fortunate to have Metro involved, and I think that's what we tried to do is direct people, because our focus was, let's organize these events, let's do this event, and for those issues, here's your resources. You know, if you have church issues, here's 10 supportive churches that are participating in this event versus the protesters spouting their nonsense.
Because it ties in for me that first Pride was a riot. Stand up, act out. You know,
act up.
Very much that those early days when HIV was just being ignored in this country, you know, and that was a radical movement, right?
Yeah.
People actually standing up and protesting.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. I won't touch the computer anymore.